And welcome back. This is the latest edition of the YouTube channel, the Robbins Headache Clinic. And today we're finishing up the psychological talk. The first couple parts were on personality disorders. We had two parts on that are on the channel. And now we're going to do the bipolar spectrum, which is a big topic in treating people with pain and headaches. And it's a big topic anyways. So, without further ado, an introduction. The bipolar spectrum, what do we mean when we talk about bipolar? It's not a great name. It used to be called manic depressive, which is a worse name. I was hoping with the latest edition of the psychiatric manual, DSM-5, that they would change the names, and instead of having bipolar, which has really a negative, pejorative construct to it, that they would change the name to Depression Plus. That's what I call it. Because mostly we're talking about the mild end of the spectrum. Now, the more severe end, which is only 12 to 15% of patients, is called bipolar type 1. And that end tends to get diagnosed. People are often psychotic. They have true mania. So they are talking very fast. Sometimes they're talking word salad, we call it, where it doesn't make any sense. They can be spending huge amounts of money. And it's not like borderline personality spending. Borderline personality, in our previous talks, people with borderline often spend consistently. You walk into their apartment and it's filled with eBay boxes and Amazon boxes that aren't even open yet. They just have to spend to constantly fill themselves up. So they'll have a closet full of 200 pairs of shoes. Bipolar spending during a manic phase is different. It's huge, but it's concentrated. So somebody might spend $20,000 in a night if they can on a casino, online, or shopping. They'll max out credit cards. And it's a little different than borderline. So mania, you have a euphoric mood. People tend to be euphoric. Sometimes it can be what we call mixed, where it's euphoria feeling high or great and dysphoria feeling depressed, and it's sort of a mixed phase. They're very distractible. They have what we call flight of ideas, where they're talking about this, talking about that, but can't concentrate, have almost no attention span. Grandiosity, I'm going to be president, I'm going to be the leader of the world, I'm going to be a rock star, a famous actor, or I'm the greatest. They have this grandiosity about them. Often excessive risk-taking with drugs and sex is very common. Very pressured speech. Too much energy. The person who wants to constantly go to another bar at 3 in the morning or play another 18 holes of golf. Now, that can be a mild mania or hypomania. Hypomania is a milder form of mania. Hypomania, it doesn't rise to the level of severely affecting the person's functioning. In true mania, people don't function very well. People are often very irritable during a manic phase and can't sleep. Some people go days, or it's even been known weeks without sleeping. Now, the mild end is really what I want to talk about more. It's not this severe mania. The mild end of the bipolar spectrum is really depression. That's what people spend a lot of their time in. That's what they complain about. If you look at the lives of, and we're talking tens of millions of people fit the spectrum, it tends to be mostly in depression or in neither depression nor mania, and only a few percent of the time are people in hypomania or too much energy. So they don't usually say, Dr. Robbins, you have to give me medicine. I have too much energy. I'm running around. It's, I'm depressed. And that's how people end up on antidepressants, which, as we'll talk about, often backfire and don't help. So the clinical stakes are high for missing bipolarity because people end up on the wrong medicine. One study indicated that it takes almost 9 years to get diagnosed right in bipolarity, and a full from the beginning of symptoms to getting on medicine that actually helps it, it's 11 or 12 years in many people. So the clinical stakes, they tend to bounce from antidepressant to antidepressant with the same predictable, not great results. We look at family history of moodiness, of hospitalization for psych, suicide, substance abuse, severe depression. Bipolar depression tends to be cyclical. People cycle in and out. So every spring or every fall they get depressed, or sometimes every summer. It's not always winter. We always think of seasonal affective disorder, SAD, and winter is worse for depression. But a lot of people, it's actually spring or summer. And with bipolar depression, there doesn't have to be a triggering event like somebody died or loss of a job or divorce, etc. It can be just cyclical for no reason. And bipolar depression tends to be more severe, deeper, more long-lasting. We also look for earlier depression. Depression starting under age 17, if you follow it along to age 25, at least 60% of the time it's bipolar or fits that spectrum. So we're always careful with kids and adolescents who have new onset depression. I don't want to just throw antidepressants around. We don't want to cycle up the brain, so we're very careful. With mild end of the bipolar spectrum, we do look at, as I mentioned, at family history, and also substance abuse is very common. Actually, in bipolar that's untreated, substance abuse is very, very common. So these cyclical depressions indicate bipolarity versus just regular chronic depression. We look at people who are agitated, quick to anger. Sometimes it's more of an indication for bipolarity. Chronically moody or too much energy, I mentioned. And the bipolar response to antidepressants. Now, you'd think antidepressant, it makes me not depressed, right? Well, the bipolar response can be the opposite, where people are more depressed. And the bipolar response to other medications, sometimes we get the opposite reaction to the benzodiazepines or response to antidepressants, which is the opposite response. People are up all night, they feel wired. People have told me they feel crazy. That's a common way to describe it. And when people get that from Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, Cymbalta, any of the usual antidepressants, we're very careful. If you look at somebody with a history of depression who goes on an antidepressant and is up all night wired or feels crazy or too much energy, that's bipolar until proven otherwise. So we can't just keep throwing antidepressants at that person. The opposite reaction to a lot of medicines can happen in people with a bipolar brain chemistry, which is all inherited. So they can go on Valium or Xanax, which should calm down the brain. It can actually trigger more bipolarity or a worse response. Sometimes Benadryl over the counter. Certainly Sudafed for colds can make people very wired and up all night. We look at cycles of brooding, irritable pessimism. Some people, hypomanias, don't come across as feeling too high or giddy. It's more this irritable, angry, pessimistic outlook that all of a sudden happens. And we look, as I mentioned, for cyclical depression for no reason. Nothing terrible is going on in their life. Now, people complain about the depression. That's how they end up on the antidepressants. And I'll talk about medicines in a little bit. But depression is the major problem. As far as numbers of people with bipolar, if we look at chronic headache patients, chronic migraine patients, I've done studies, other people have done studies. We looked at over 1,000 consecutive migraine patients, and over 8% fit the bipolar spectrum. Some studies have had that as 10%. If we look at just tension headache, people who don't have migraines, it's more like 4.5-5%, which is around the national population is probably 4-4.5% fit the bipolar spectrum. And in cluster headache, we found about 6% fit. Looking the other way, if you look at a population of people who have been diagnosed bipolar, at least 30% have migraines. So we've asked the psychiatrist to begin to look for migraines, ask them, because it's relatively easy, not always so difficult to treat simple migraines. I think that psychiatrists can treat migraines, and if a third of their bipolar patients have migraine, they should be looking and asking the questions. So how do we treat bipolar once we've diagnosed it? Psychotherapy is very important. We do what we call social rhythm therapy, which is making sure people get out, are not isolated. A lot of people isolate themselves, and that makes everything worse. We try to keep people connected to family and friends and job. We try to encourage exercise 20 minutes a day or so on average, walking, treadmill, bike. I like people to have a stationary bike at home. It's the most used piece of equipment. Treadmills, unfortunately, end up being a lot of times fancy clothes hangers, and the bike is more used. If we shop for where you can put a laptop on it, watch TV, or a newspaper. Of course, if you're under 40 years old, I have to explain what a newspaper is. It's one of those things you open up, it has print on it and everything. But exercise, yoga, Pilates, these are all really good. Even 5 minutes is worth it. Weight and weight gain are often an issue with bipolar medicines, but patients anyways. So we end up talking a lot about weight. We don't want to use medicines that cause a lot of weight gain in somebody who has an issue, which is over half the people. That's a big problem. And we do encourage mindful meditation or learning some meditation. Now, turning to medications, everybody is unique. If you have 100 people with the bipolar spectrum or with headaches, we go 100 different ways. And in a future talk, I'm going to give this talk called Choosing Headache Medications or Deconstructing the Art of Headache Medicine. And there's 50 inputs that go in why we choose this medicine versus that. With headaches, it involves how severe their headaches are, family history, finances, job requirements, weight, tiredness, stomach issues. And a similar process goes on with choosing psychological medicines or psychiatric medicines. Weight gain is an issue, tiredness. Can the person afford to be tired in the morning? If they have to get up at 6 in the morning and function at a high level, or they're in school, we don't want to give them sedating things at night that are going to knock the person out. If people are 20% overweight, we don't want to give medicines that cause a 30-pound weight gain. So all these considerations go into the mix. We try to minimize medicine, but there have been nationwide studies where two medicines do work better than one for bipolar and three work better than one or two. So sometimes medicines will work for one symptom and not for another. We always start with low doses, and we look at comorbidities, which is what else is going on with a person. Do they have headaches? Do they have high blood pressure? Do they have diabetes, asthma, etc.? Most medicines are pretty good at helping the highs of bipolarity and too much energy. There's not that much that helps the depression. So, and that, as I mentioned, is the big problem. Now, as far as mood stabilizers, these are a little different than antidepressants. There's three classes of mood stabilizers, and they are not antidepressants, but they help the depression, if that makes any sense. The three classes are what we call atypicals, atypical antipsychotics, and I hate that name because over 90% and of people, probably 95% of people, are never psychotic, but they're on these medicines, so it's a terrible name. You know, somebody comes in, and I say, you know, I think you fit the bipolar spectrum. I use that word, and we're going to use an antipsychotic. It's just terrible, the stigma. But the atypicals, the anticonvulsant, the seizure medicines, and lithium. So we'll talk about these. The antipsychotics, atypicals, lamotrigine, Lamictal is the number one, and it's actually a pretty safe medicine. 1 out of 3,000 people get a serious rash. So it's only 1 out of 3,000, and if people get a rash on Lamictal, we stop it. Most people get the rash, it's just a normal drug rash, it's not the serious rash. Serious rashes that we worry about are on palms of the hands, soles of the feet, mucous membranes around the mouth. The regular allergic rash is truncal rash over the body that happens. We stop the medicine anyways. But lamotrigine, Lamictal, we go up slowly over a month or two. And outside of the rash, people don't get weight gain. It's very, very well tolerated. They don't get tiredness usually. And Lamictal, lamotrigine, is probably the number one bipolar medicine. It can help the depression. It can also help the highs. As far as the antipsychotics, now that's an anti-seizure medicine. The atypicals, we have a lot of them. Abilify, aripiprazole is the generic. It's generic now, but it's still sort of expensive. We do shop for cheaper medicines or look on goodrx.com. That's all one word, goodrx.com shows the cheapest pharmacy in the area for that drug. So a lot of people who don't have great drug coverage, we use sites such as that. Abilify is advertised a lot. It's indicated for regular depression, for bipolar depression, but it can cause tiredness or weight gain. There's a number of others in that category, quetiapine, which is Seroquel, and risperidone, Risperdal, and there's a new one, Rexulti, R-E-X-U-L-T-I, and actually a newer one than that called Vraylar, V-R-A-Y-L-A-R. There's all kinds of choices, and these are a little different from each other. Some of them help the highs and the psychotic feelings more than the depression. Now, I mentioned Lamictal is an anti-seizure medicine, anticonvulsant. It's probably number one, but there are others. Sodium valproate, which is Depakote, is commonly used. It can cause weight gain. But if somebody doesn't have big weight issues, Depakote is very good if they have headaches, particularly, because it also really helps the headaches. We have carbamazepine, which is Tegretol, or a similar one, oxcarbazepine, which is Trileptal, and there's a good long-acting form of that. I like these because they have less side effects, the newer ones like oxcarbazepine, better than the older Tegretol. But these are very good for moods. Again, they can stabilize the highs. They don't always help the depression, although sometimes they do. And another seizure medicine that has been used quite a bit is gabapentin, used to be called Neurontin. It failed in early studies 20 years ago, but those studies looked at really severe mania. For mild end of the bipolar spectrum, I think gabapentin is not always a bad medicine. It's a very safe drug. Lithium is the other class of mood stabilizer, and lithium is underused. It's really probably 20% more patients could probably be on it. It's been around for many years. It may not work quite as well as 30 years ago in some patients because once people get on antidepressants, their brain sort of cycles up. It's like sometimes putting an antidepressant on the brain of somebody with the bipolar spectrum is like adding gasoline on a fire. It really cycles the brain up. And some people, though, tolerate antidepressants just fine. But lithium, we try to use low doses. There's issues long-term, like lowering thyroid with lithium. But using low doses, we can usually keep people on it long-term. Now, the antidepressants are used, and sometimes people do tolerate them with a bipolar spectrum. It's all over the place. Some people cannot tolerate a drop of serotonin, a drop of an antidepressant, and they get manic-y. Other people are fine. Most people need to be on a mood stabilizer, one of the ones that we just talked about, to take the antidepressants. But we use low doses as the key. Sometimes stimulants are used. You would think that Adderall or Vyvanse or Ritalin stimulants would cycle people up and cause hypomania, and sometimes it does. But more often it calms down the brain, and a lot of people with bipolar also have ADHD, and the stimulants can help. We're careful with addicting medicines, opioids or benzodiazepines. Sometimes a commonly used drug for headache, which is Topamax, topiramate, can actually cause depression. Occasionally it helps moods, but it's more likely to cause depression. Now, a sample case study, say this is a fictional case, Derek is a 52-year-old man who comes in and he has a year of headaches and feels very charged up and wired, and he was placed on Paxil, and he was up all night wired and couldn't sleep. Then he went over to Zoloft, and same thing happened, and then another doctor put him on Prozac. This is a common scenario. He has bad headaches. He doesn't know his family history on one side. The other side doesn't have any history of depression or anything. But it turns out Derek was depressed in the eighth grade for 6 months, moderate to severe depression, and then was fine until age 52. So he feels that his body is all charged up, he has these severe headaches. We try a couple of other medicines, and finally Derek gets on lithium in a small dose, and it calms everything down. And he felt as if his body feels 90% calmer. His brain is not going constantly. And in this situation, lithium does help the headaches, although it doesn't always, it doesn't actually usually help headaches except for cluster headaches. And that's a typical case history pointing out that people with bipolar, it's not a lifelong condition where it happens at age 4, people get very depressed, and that's it. It can be an off and on cyclical condition. It can start in midlife, and it can even start, there's certainly many cases, situations where we have late life onset of bipolarity. Now with Derek, we might consider increasing lithium, the Depakote, or Lamictal. So everybody is different. If he doesn't have a weight problem, we might go with Depakote. Some resources for personality disorders and for bipolarity for physicians: Neuroscience Education Institute, NEI, and the U.S. Psychiatric and Mental Health Congress. Patients can also access U.S. Psychiatric and Mental Health Congress online. Some good web sources, BD for bipolar, BPD resources, bpdresourcecenter.org, I found very good, psychcentral.com, and there is a DBSA, Depression and Bipolar Support Alliance out of Chicago, that's fairly good. And there's a lot of books along the personality disorder line. The Stop Walking on Eggshells series has been very good. Borderline Personality Disorder Demystified has been good. And there's the Essential Family Guide to Personality Disorder. For people with a parent who is very difficult, there's Children of the Self-Absorbed and Surviving a Borderline Parent. There's a lot of good resources out there. And other resources for bipolarity, I look for books that really talk about the bipolar 2 or bipolar 3, the milder end of the bipolar spectrum. Many of them emphasize mania, but the demystified books, Bipolar Demystified, has been good towards that. So I think I'll wrap up this section of our psychological talk, and we're going to be putting on a new lecture next week. Thank you.